We humans are biologically eukaryotes. In other words, we're multicellular organisms, and those cells that make up us are eukaryotic cells rather than prokaryotic cells. But when did eukaryotic cells evolve and how? The evolution of eukaryotes started with what I'm calling Pac-Man prokaryotes. But before we talk about what that means, let me talk a little bit about what eukaryotes are and how they differ from prokaryotes. It's important to remember that the origin of multicellular life, like ourselves, is not the same as the origin of eukaryotes, because eukaryotes are not defined by multicellularity. Single-celled eukaryotes were first to evolve and still survive today, things like protozoans, algae, and fungi. However, multicellular life, in which these single-celled eukaryote organisms evolved into, did come about later on. But today, we'll be talking about the evolution of eukaryotic cells, so single-celled eukaryotes, that happened before, of course, the multicellularity thing. And in terms of differences between eukaryotes and prokaryotes, well, here in the center of the screen, you can see an example of a prokaryotic cell, which prokaryotes include things like bacteria and archaea. And then on the right, you can see an example of a eukaryotic cell. And eukaryotes have a membrane-bound nucleus that stores chromosomes. They have a cytoskeleton, which we'll talk about later, because that allows them to change shape, and that the evolution of the cytoskeleton was important for the evolution of eukaryotic cells as a whole. And then they also have a stiffened cell membrane that's stiffened by molecules called sterols, which eventually became important molecules as biomarkers in the rock record for when eukaryotes evolved, because prokaryotes don't have those in their cell membrane. And then organelles, which are like mitochondria and chloroplasts, as we can see within the eukaryotic cell, those are not present in prokaryotes, so they're only present in eukaryotic cells. And then they also have a larger genome than prokaryotes. So how exactly did eukaryotes evolve? Well, Lynn Margulis in 1970-ish proposed endosymbiosis as being a theory for how eukaryotic cells evolved. And that involves one prokaryote engulfing another, and that prokaryote ends up becoming one of the organelles in the host cell that becomes the eukaryote. And this theory seems awfully simple, and also it was really laughed at the beginning. But in a few slides, I'm going to talk about all the evidence that we have for that now, and now, you know, we know that it is true. But why might these prokaryotes have engulfed one another, and had that been beneficial for them in the first place? Well, the engulfed prokaryote is benefited by protection from the host cell and also a source of carbon and nutrients. And then the engulfer, the host cell, is benefited by extra ATP produced by the engulfed cell. Eventually, they became interdependent after living this symbiotic relationship for a while, and the engulfed cell within the host cell became the host cell's mitochondrion. And then the same process occurred for other organelles like the chloroplast. So let's walk step by step through how this might have happened. So there's a hypothesis called the hydrogen hypothesis, which hypothesizes exactly step by step how the endosymbiosis would have happened, why it was forced upon these prokaryotes. And so step one is that hydrogen became limited for anaerobic bacteria that needed it, such as methanogens potentially. And methanogens use hydrogen as an electron donor to chemically reduce or give electrons to carbon dioxide, making it reduced carbon in the form of methane. And that's why they're methanogens, they produce methane. So these methanogens would have needed another source of hydrogen in a hydrogen-limited environment. And to establish this source of hydrogen, they became closely associated with fermenting bacteria. The archaea eventually evolved a cytoskeleton in order to alter their cell shape to increase the surface area to maximize contact with these bacteria that are giving them their electron donor, their hydrogen. So now you can see why the evolution of a cytoskeleton was probably really important before the actual evolution or rest of the evolutionary steps toward eukaryotic cells. And eventually the bacterium was fully engulfed by the host archaea, and the transfer of genes between bacteria and archaea at that point, because we know back then lateral gene transfer was rampant, and especially among communities that live next to each other. And you can imagine it was probably even more easy to transfer cells when one prokaryote was engulfed by another. So at that point, the transfer of genes allowed the host to meet both its carbon and energy needs, as well as the needs of its engulfed symbiont cell, heterotrophically. So at the beginning, it was an autotroph because it used carbon dioxide, inorganic carbon, for its carbon source, and it used hydrogen as an electron donor, again, inorganic, and so it didn't need organic carbon. However, the heterotroph metabolism of the fermenting bacteria, those genes had transferred to the host cell, and it could now metabolize heterotrophically, which then caused it to evolve into a chemoheterotroph, using glucose as a source of reduced organic carbon, and therefore gaining more energy from its metabolic process than when it was a methanogen. Therefore, it was, you know, advantageous for this guy to evolve into a heterotroph after it got those genes and that you know, ability. And the symbiont evolved into its mitochondrion. And the incorporation of the symbiont led to an eventual increase in size and complexity of the host cell, or the new cell type. And such complexity would have required a mitochondrion to have evolved by then, because that's an energy creating and conserving organelle. If you've ever taken any bio 101 class, you know, the powerhouse of the cell, they always say, is the mitochondrion. And bacteria and archaea, or prokaryotes, don't have this. So when it evolved, they were like, oh my gosh, we can do so many more things now. We can become more complex and larger. And then they did so. And so now we think, based on this hypothesis and just the endosymbiosis hypothesis in general, that an aerobic bacterium, like the one we just talked about being engulfed, likely became the mitochondria for eukaryotic cells, and cyanobacteria were engulfed in a similar process to become chloroplasts of algae and plants and everything that is eukaryotic and photosynthesizes. They photosynthesize because they have chloroplasts. The chloroplast is the center of the photosynthesis, because it used to be a cyanobacteria, which was the only thing on Earth to ever evolve that function of converting light energy into chemical energy. That's why everything else since then has needed a cyanobacterium of its own. And it has one. It's just that we call it a chloroplast. The real evidence that points to the mitochondria and chloroplasts being previously their own organism is that they have distinct DNA and RNA, or genetic material, from the host cell. It's different than the host cell. And they also have their own membranes, their membrane bound, which until the invention of eukaryotes had only been the case for cells, had a membrane, but nobody had any organelles, especially membrane bound organelles. So because they have their own membrane, that's more evidence that they used to be their own cell and organism. And they also make their own proteins, which are, these are all functions that prokaryotes that came before them, obviously still live now, can do and do, and then were engulfed, and they continue to do within their host cell. And then another piece of evidence, like I kind of already mentioned, is that chloroplasts, not only do they share a number of shockingly similar traits with cyanobacteria, but they also photosynthesize. Oxygenic photosynthesis, which is carried out by cyanobacteria and has been for billions of years on Earth, is unique to either cyanobacteria or things that contain chloroplasts that used to be cyanobacteria. The mitochondria and chloroplasts also have their own reproductive mechanisms, and they're also susceptible to antibiotics. The most phylogenetically ancient eukaryotes, however, lack mitochondria, and also many other organelles that characterize most eukaryotes today. And this could mean that early eukaryotes evolved other eukaryotic traits like nuclei before evolving mitochondria. However, recent studies show that amitochondriates, or eukaryotes without mitochondria, likely once possessed mitochondria. So they lost it through evolutionary changes, but they probably once had it, which implies that mitochondria probably did evolve prior to nuclei, which is more consistent with the energy requirements it takes to be more complex as a cell and to have nuclei and other things that eukaryotes have, because they would have needed to evolve a mitochondria to be able to have the energy to be more complex. But it's still debated. We don't know for sure. We know endosymbiosis happened at some point to make the mitochondria, but we don't know whether it was before or after the nucleus began to evolve. Then eukaryotes were allowed to diversify into both single and multicellular organisms eventually. How long ago is another question. Steranes, those membrane-stiffening molecules I talked about earlier, are a good indicator of eukaryotic existence in the rock record, and they're very, you know, persistent in terms of preservation, and so we can find them in the rock record, and they're preserved. And they go back all the way to 2.7 billion years ago, suggesting that eukaryotes could have evolved by then. But more unequivocal evidence for eukaryotic evolution is 2.1 billion-year-old algae. Then we have oldest acrotarch fossils, which I've seen anywhere from 1.8 to 1.5 billion years ago, are when they came on the scene. And these are ancient eukaryotic organisms that are now extinct, but they had evolved at some point in the 1.8 to 1.5 billion year ago range. And then we have multicellular red algae, which came about around 1.2 billion years ago. However, the biodiversity remained relatively low until the Neoproterozoic, around like 700 to 550-ish million years ago, when things really started to kick off in the Ediacaran with the Ediacaran fauna, the Cambrian with the Cambrian explosion. But what exactly is the reason for low diversity before the Neoproterozoic and high diversity during and after? Well, to answer the first question, the low diversity before is in part due to kind of many things. The first thing I've listed here is no hard parts, so poor preservation. This is not so much a reason for low diversity as it is for apparently low diversity. So it might seem like there was less diversity then because there was less preservation, or that might contribute to our, you know, thought of how low the diversity was. Additionally, in terms of apparent low diversity is the lack of rock record. Not only was there poor preservation because soft bodies and soft organisms hadn't evolved skeletons and shells yet, but also because there's a lack of rock record the further back you go. However, the lack of actual diversity might have been due to a lack of habitable environments because there was a lack of oxygen in the deep ocean. I talk in many of my videos about how the great oxidation event happened 2.4-ish to 2.2-ish billion years ago, but that was mainly the oxidation of the atmosphere and the surface oceans, not so much the deep oceans. For a while, about a billion to a billion and a half years, we think the deep ocean remained anoxic and pretty sulfidic, so pretty toxic to anything, especially animal or eukaryotic type of life that would have wanted to live there. And so that decreased habitable seafloor, which is where eukaryotes eventually did diversify and become more complex, is on the seafloor. So that environment was really important for them, and a lot of it wasn't available. Snowball Earth also decreased habitable environments and made the environment as a whole pretty not great. And Snowball Earth events came about because of the oxidation of the Earth and cooling that resulted from more carbon burial and oxygen released to the atmosphere, because, you know, more carbon burial means less carbon dioxide and methane in the atmosphere, meaning cooling of Earth and eventually glaciation. And these events were really, you know, they weren't just like today's ice age. They were really intense ice ages. And that's why we call them Snowball Earth, because it was almost fully covered like a snowball. And then lastly, for the low diversity before Neoproterozoic, is lower oxygen not only decreased habitable environments in the seafloor, but also limited energy yields. Because oxygen hadn't risen again later in the Neoproterozoic, it rises again after the GEO, the great oxidation event. There's a later oxidation event that helped rise oxygen more to the point that organisms could become more complex because they had metabolisms with higher energy yields. So why the high diversity and the evolution of skeletons and hard parts during and after the Neoproterozoic? Well, the termination of snowball Earth events helped in a few ways. One, it just wasn't so inhospitable to life, but two, the warming that caused the termination of snowball Earth events led to shallow sea environments transgressing or rising and moving onto continental masses. And these shallow sea environments produced a lot of habitable environments for animals and newly evolved species to take over and to diversify in these brand new niches on the shallow sea floor, where, you know, things that live in biodiverse areas of the ocean today like to live. So these were great environments for animal diversification. Two is higher oxygen and more habitable environments. Like I mentioned, with more oxygen rising in the Neoproterozoic, closer to that 550 million year mark that marks the Cambrian, that rise in oxygen allowed a deeper ocean oxygenation and more habitable seafloor environments. Then you had a change in ocean chemistry that caused basically more calcium to be transported to the oceans and phosphate. And this allowed calcium phosphate and calcium carbonate skeletons to eventually form and be favorable in terms of biological secretion of those products for skeletons and shells and hard parts. You also had stromatolite grazing. Algal and cyanobacterial mats, which preserve as stromatolites, were very abundant throughout much of the Precambrian because they were, you know, one of the main things around. And eventually cyanobacteria are what caused the great oxidation event. But their mats took up a lot of habitable environment space. And when grazers evolved to graze down these stromatolites, they cleared seafloor area for other organisms to diversify in. And then another reason skeletons were really advantageous. So instead of an allowance, like ocean chemistry allowing skeletons to be able to form and oxygen allowing them to have higher energy yields to form skeletons, the predators, the evolution of more advanced predators at this time, contributed to the evolution of skeletons by making it advantageous. Not only could they make skeletons because of these other factors now, but they also needed to. And natural selection eventually led to the ones with skeletons, you know, staying alive. But I talk about more reasons and more factors that played a role than this, as well as the timing reason and mechanisms for these events in my Cambrian explosion video. So if you want to check out my Cambrian explosion video, I will put it up here on the screen. You should be able to click it when it pops up. And then you can also check out my When Life Moved to Land video, because I think that's relatively related to all of this. And then my historical geology playlist should also pop up here if you want to check out any of those other videos. And for my references, like always, I'm using my Geomicrobiology and Earth Systems History book. I use this one a lot for the other historical videos. But I use this microbial one for my geobio playlist, and this one's kind of like a crossover video. So you can check out both of these in my description below, as well as other minor supporting references. And lastly, guys, if you want to join my channel as a channel member, you can do so below by pressing join, and you will get extra content and perks from being a channel member. But I understand if you can't or don't want to do that. If you would rather, you can just give this video a thumbs up. I would really, really appreciate that. And thank you so much for watching. I'll see you guys next time. Bye.